Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Paul Provo, and I'm president of 6P Marketing and chair of the Manitoba Chambers of Commerce. Manitoba Chambers of Commerce's offices are located on original lands of Anishinaabeg, Cree, Oji Cree, Dakota, and Dene peoples, and on the homeland of the Red River Métis Nation. We respect the treaties that were made on these territories. We acknowledge the harms and mistakes of the past, and we dedicate ourselves to move forward in partnership with Indigenous communities in the spirit of reconciliation and collaboration. It is my honor to be your host for this virtual event as we welcome Manitoba's Senior Cabinet Minister, the Honourable Daniel Vandal, for a keynote presentation and moderated question and answer segment. COVID-19 has created a public health crisis and an economic challenge unlike anything any of us have seen before. Over the course of the past 21 months, the government had response programs and policies have been critical to supporting workers and preserving our country's entrepreneurial landscape. The government of Canada has been responsive, agile, committed to communication, and open to consulting with industry and the chamber network about the design, amendments to, and extension of emergency relief measures. From individual worker benefits to wage and rent subsidies, hiring programs, tax and interest deferrals, and special funds and loans for the hardest hit sectors and disproportionately affected segments, the Government of Canada has rolled out a policy in record time. And this massive economic event is among the most significant in Canada's history, resulting in a deficit of more than $314 billion for fiscal 2020-21. Before I formally introduce today's special guest, a few housekeeping items. We've muted all participants for best audio quality. Minister Vandal will have approximately 20 to 25 minutes to address participants. Following his remarks, Manitoba's Chambers of Commerce President and CEO, Chuck Davidson, will lead a moderated question and answer session with the minister. We did receive questions in advance and they will be addressed first. If you didn't have a chance to submit a question or maybe a new question has arisen for you, please post it in the Q&A panel immediately to the bottom of your screen. Chuck can manage those questions in real time. And now to introduce our special guest, Minister Daniel Vandal. Minister Vandal is a Métis who represents the riding of St. Boniface, St. Vital, of which I grew up in and currently reside. A graduate of the University of Manitoba with a Bachelor of Social Work, Minister Vandal believes in giving back to his community. He has a long record of service in St. Boniface, where he served five terms as a Winnipeg City Councillor. At City Hall, he served as Deputy Mayor and was a tireless advocate for urban renewal and for better public spaces and vibrant neighborhoods across the city. He also helped develop Winnipeg's Aboriginal Youth Strategy, the first of its kind in Canada. Minister Vandal has been a member of Parliament since 2015, and in August of 2018 was appointed Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister of Indigenous Services. In 2019, he was named Minister of Northern Affairs, adding to his portfolio minister responsible for Prairies Economic Development Canada, or PrairiesCan, and minister responsible for Canadian Northern Economic Development Agency following the 2021 federal election. Busy. His mandate is to invest in the prairies, creating a more diversified economy in Alberta, Saskatchewan, and Manitoba, and to lead government's work in the north, creating greater economic opportunities and a better quality of life for Northerners. Today, he joins us to share the federal government's perspective on COVID-19 recovery, to answer questions related to strategic investment in our region, and to share his vision for Manitoba. Minister Vandal, welcome to today's Manitoba Poly Power Hour. The floor is yours. Minister, you're on mute.
I can't tell you how many times I've heard that over the last year and a half. Thank you so much, Paul. Et bonjour tout le monde et merci pour cette gentille présentation. I'm speaking to you from West Block in Ottawa on unceded Algonquin and Anishinaabe Nation territory. And Ottawa has long been a gathering place for First Nations, Inuit, and Métis across Canada. I recognize that all you and your team at the Manitoba Chamber of Commerce for supporting Manitobans with relief and recovery efforts. The pandemic has impacted absolutely everyone. While dealing with your own challenges, your team has stepped up and was instrumental in helping our government deliver quick funding that helped Manitoba businesses and industries respond and survive the pandemic. The Manitoba Chamber continues to do exceptional work. I can also see that the Digital Manitoba Initiative has been a necessity, and I applaud you for that. Your team saw a gap and bridged it by helping local businesses with their digital transformation. It's the same thing with Retrain Manitoba. Nothing will matter as much as talent as we move to the next stage of economic recovery. Also, the Buy Local initiative, it allowed us to support local, make an impact, and come together as Manitobans. So thank you to you and your team for all that you do and for bringing us together this afternoon. Over the last 2 years, I've had the honor to serve as Minister of Northern Affairs, most of which during the pandemic, during a very challenging time for Canadians, for families, and for businesses, of course. My team and I have worked very closely with provincial, territorial, and Indigenous partners, along with industry, businesses, and other stakeholders, to keep people healthy and safe, and to support local enterprise and economies. Relief programs were rolled out very swiftly, and they were modified as needed. As a government, we are committed to being there for Canadians, and we will continue to do so. I'm further honored that the Prime Minister has entrusted me with the additional responsibilities as Minister responsible for Canadian Northern Economic Development Agency, or CanNor, which is the equivalent of PrairiesCan, and also as Minister responsible for Prairies Economic Development Canada, PrairiesCan. My team and I have begun this important work, and I look forward to working with all of you as we continue to recover from the pandemic and grow and diversify the economy. Our government was also pleased to announce yesterday that the fall economic update will be released by the Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance on December the 14th. First and foremost, I'm here as a fellow Manitoban. As many of you know, I have deep roots in Winnipeg. I served 5 terms on City Council with 3 different mayors and as Deputy Mayor. I'm also committed to Winnipeg, I'm committed to Manitoba and to the West. I'm here as a minister committed to create the future we need and we want to see on the prairies. I've been fortunate over recent weeks and months to have spent a lot of time at home with members of the community. I've been listening to concerns, I've been listening to Manitobans' aspirations and their input to shape an ambitious agenda. We all know Manitoba's history as a meeting place that is a product of many people's ideas, cultures, and communities. All these elements have forged our shared identity as Manitobans and created our greatest strength. Manitoba is where our traditional strengths have given rise to emerging areas of opportunity, where people with very diverse backgrounds and experience are introduced to unique cultures, where tradition can meet new ideas, new technology to create a special diversity that we call home. Our home is a place with strong Indigenous trade networks from east to west, from Canada's only deep water port in the north to where the Assiniboine and the Red River meet in the south. These rich trade networks led to Winnipeg becoming the hub that it is today. They are the basis for our agricultural, our financial, our transportation, and our resources-based expertise. We are seeking what access to improved infrastructure, new markets, new ideas, and new technology is doing to create emerging opportunities for Manitoba. Agriculture is a great example of old meeting new. Over the last 5 years, agri-food companies such as Roquette, the world's largest pea processing plant, Merit Foods, Simplot, High Life, and Parmalat have invested over $1 billion to expand operations right here in Manitoba. We can and need to do more to seize these opportunities across the region. Setting up our communities for success includes a technology-enabled future with advanced precision agriculture and plant protein. It also means building on Manitoba's traditional transportation strengths and today's zero emission vehicles. Our local companies like Motor Coach, New Flyer, JCA Electronics, and Westward Industries are leading the zero emissions heavy equipment vehicle manufacturing industry that exports nearly $2 billion in value every year. And as you know, the Government of Canada is committed to net zero emissions by 2050. And thanks to the industry partners who are stepping up to help Manitoba contribute to that goal. Manitoba's hydroelectric strengths are complemented by our transportation and warehousing sector, which moves the world's people, resources, and goods in sustainable ways. If you add in a connection to our digital agricultural firms, such as Farmers Edge, that is helping our farmers reduce their carbon footprint, and we do have something very, very special right here in the heart of Canada. Manitoba's tourism, arts, and culture industries are also front and center, representing an important part of our provincial GDP and total employment. Our art scene is very rich with internationally renowned Royal Winnipeg Ballet, who I met yesterday in Ottawa, the world-class Winnipeg Symphony Orchestra, the Manitoba Opera, festivals such as the Folk Festival, which I understand will be returning to its traditional format in 2022, and Festival du Voyageur, and cultural hubs like Hammerjork in the Winnipeg Art Gallery, boasting the largest collection of Inuit art in the world. The world around us continues to evolve through digitization, helping create interactive and engaging experiences that bring people together. In this day and age where our children are coming together on TikTok and other social media platforms, they are primed to demand jobs and digitization amongst other fields. And we can give them that in our emerging digital companies like Frantic Films, Buffalo Gal Pictures, Skip the Dishes, Bold, and much more. This new generation industry and our robust arts and culture sector are predominantly based in the downtown of Winnipeg. And we need the downtowns of our cities to match that vitality. Downtown Winnipeg has 70% of the city's office space, and prior to the pandemic, 70,000 people worked downtown, which is greater than the population of Manitoba's second largest city, Brandon. A thriving downtown is imperative to the health of our economy. We have a duty to ensure our downtown core in Winnipeg can thrive as a meeting place. We recently rolled out the Canada Community Revitalization Fund, a $500 million commitment over 2 years that will help bring people back to public spaces safely while supporting not-for-profits, municipalities, and communities. And when speaking of communities, we must acknowledge that Winnipeg is home to Canada's largest urban Indigenous population. Manitoba has the second youngest average provincial population in the country. If we are not engaging our youth or the Indigenous population, if we are not presenting them with opportunities and hope, then why are we here? When I was a city councilor representing St. Boniface, I was extremely proud to work with three different mayors to work on Canada's Aboriginal Youth Strategy, Winnipeg's Aboriginal Youth Strategy, I may say, the first of its kind in Canada. It's an issue that I take seriously and one that all governments must take seriously. And across Canada, the number of Indigenous businesses is growing at 5 times the rate of self-employed Canadians, and Indigenous women are starting businesses at twice the rate of non-Indigenous. Indigenous people represent the fastest growth segment of the population, and Indigenous entrepreneurship is and will continue to be a driving force of Canada's long-term economic stability. At $30 billion today, Indigenous businesses are expected to grow by $100 billion by 2025, which is not far away at all. And a prime example is what we are seeing with the Arctic Gateway Group, a majority-owned Indigenous business that owns and operates the Hudson's Bay Railroad, the Port of Churchill and other related assets. Our government has been there with over close to $170 million in support since 2018. And the last tranche was flowed just last August. And we will continue to be there for Arctic Gateway and other Indigenous businesses and the people of Churchill and Northern Manitoba. Churchill is a very, very important part of the Arctic and Northern policy framework, which is the overarching document that our government introduced in 2019 for Northern Canada and the Arctic. Our vision is that Northern people and Arctic people living in the Arctic are thriving, are strong, and are safe. We need to keep our talent at home in Manitoba and provide opportunities for growth. That's not only the right thing to do, but it also provides new sources of innovative ideas that have the potential to change the world and strengthen Canada's leadership as a nation of innovators right here in Manitoba. So how are we going to do that? How will we come back together to build back better, support key businesses, drive growth in multiple sectors, revive the heartbeat of our downtowns, support our communities, and compete in global markets? Those are questions that we need to explore together. I feel very fortunate to be the minister responsible for PrairiesCan. Budget 21 announced the intention to create separate regional development agencies for British Columbia and for the Prairies. And I want to thank my Manitoba colleagues, Jim Carr, Terry Duguid, Kevin Lamoureux, for the fantastic work they did in shepherding PrairiesCan. That in August, we announced that Economic Development Canada, as I said, PacificCan and the PrairiesCan were formed in August of 21. Both Pacific and PrairiesCan built on the impressive history of Western economic diversification. Over the last decade alone, WD had touched over 840 communities, 5,700 for-profits, 1,500 not-for-profits, and supported 86,000 jobs en français et en anglais. These are good numbers, but the better news is that we are positioned to do more with a very focused approach to full-service economic development in Manitoba and in the Prairies. And my role is to grow and diversify the prairie economy and advance prairie interests in Ottawa. PrairiesCan will invest, sharing the risk and accelerating the growth of businesses that create local jobs and growth through strategic investments and targeted initiatives. PrairiesCan will advise. We will inform economic decision-making and advocate for prairie interests in Ottawa. And PrairiesCan will convene, connect economic actors in order to support collaboration and growth. And PrairiesCan will pathfind by helping people, businesses, and families navigate federal economic programs and services. Right now, there are programs ready to support businesses and community needs. We are working hard to move past the pandemic, to move to the prosperity on the other side of all the trouble we've seen and been through since early 2020. And our government has been there and continues to be there for the prairies. Pandemic recovery programs alone announced in budget 2021 provide over $360 million for PrairiesCan. And this includes $81 million through the Tourism Relief Fund through PrairiesCan, $128.5 million over 3 years to PrairiesCan, to the Jobs and Growth Fund, providing funding for businesses and organizations to help create jobs and position local economies for long-term growth, $99.3 million over 2 years to PrairiesCan through the Canada Community Revitalization Fund, which will help communities across the prairies build and improve community infrastructure projects so that we can rebound from the effects of COVID-19 pandemic. $33 million over 3 years to PrairiesCan through the Aerospace Regional Recovery Initiative to help the Canadian aerospace sector emerge from the pandemic and continue to compete on the global stage. And over $20 million over 2 years to PrairiesCan through the Major Festivals and Events Support Initiative, supporting major Canadian festivals and events that have been hit hard by the economic impacts of COVID-19 to adapt and to enhance their activities as the economy recovers. In addition to these programs from Budget 2021 to PrairiesCan, $461 million in relief funding was delivered to over 6,800 businesses in critical need of support through the Regional Relief Recovery Fund, RRRRF. I'm sure you've all heard of it. This is real money. A significant amount is out the door, but not all of it. This fund was an urgent relief program for eligible businesses and organizations that did not qualify for other program supports. By the time the application period closed last June, demand in Western Canada was higher than the rest of the country. This is one of the reasons why our government topped up the RRRF fund with an additional $500 million, bringing the total funds available to $2 billion. And I can assure absolutely everyone watching that PrairiesCan has absolutely not been left out of funding from the federal government. In fact, 9 out of every $10 in support through COVID-19 were federal dollars. The money is real, it's there. And you can count on it. Earlier this year, the Regional Air Transportation Initiative provided vital funding to key airports that are instrumental in ensuring Manitoba's economy remains strong on the other side of this pandemic. We cannot recover without airports in Thompson, in Flin Flon, in the Paw, in Brandon, being ready and able to service regional communities. Our government is committed to strategic infrastructure projects through the Investing in Canada plan. This plan supports vital public transit systems, clean water and wastewater systems, and social infrastructure for all communities, including the North. The plan is part of our commitment to creating long-term economic growth that builds a stronger middle class and boosts socioeconomic outcomes for all Canadian communities. And I can tell you right now that we are working towards establishing 7 new service locations in the prairies. For Manitoba, that means on top of the existing office in Winnipeg, we have a new service location in Thompson and a new service location in Brandon. They will position us better to engage with more of the very communities that we are privileged to serve. These locations will play an extremely important role as PrairiesCan delivers a full suite of economic development supports when PrairiesCan assists businesses, innovators, and communities and manages pandemic recovery program. More resources for PrairiesCan as an economic development agency for the prairies to work with business leaders, Indigenous partners, innovation spaces, community economic development organizations, and you, the people on the call. Significant consultation has taken place over recent weeks and months with yourself, with partners, with other community members, stakeholders, to build this agenda. And I want to commend the tremendous work of Melanie Joly, Minister of Economic Development, who's now Foreign Minister, on the Regional Economic Development Agency files. I know you have all shared the need to come together to spur debate, to have debate, and to create new ideas as key to a dynamic economy. To succeed in defining our own place in the world, we must continue to build on our history as a meeting place where we foster great people, great ideas, amazing culture, and vibrant and healthy communities in ways that are uniquely Manitoban. Together, we look forward to supporting the businesses that will deliver the jobs that people count on. We'll help communities create the right conditions for the success of those businesses to ensure our children and the people of Manitoba are equipped with the right skill sets and tools towards a healthy and prosperous future. Merci beaucoup. C'est un plaisir d'être ici aujourd'hui, Miigwech, and thank you.
Minister Vandal, I just want to take this opportunity to thank you for spending some time with us this afternoon on this MB Poly Power Hour event, for going through a listing and an overview of what the federal government has done to date and some of the plans kind of going future and moving forward. So we'll have a bit of a discussion. We've got about 25 minutes. We're going to ask some questions on some of the what you talked upon and some of the questions that if people on the line want to feed into the Q&A as well, we can do that. You know, I kind of want to start obviously with just the fact that, you know, obviously from a business community perspective and from the Manitoba Chamber of Commerce perspective, just really want to thank you and your government for some of the supports that you've provided to the business community throughout this. You know, you mentioned close to $9 out of every $10 that was provided to the business community, whether it's through wage subsidy programs or rental rent programs, and a number of others have been absolutely critical for the support that the business community has provided. So, you know, thank you on behalf of the business community. I do want to start with the, you know, just in regards to the throne speech was mentioned last week, and continue some of the supports for some of those hardest hit sectors that we have. And we know some of those in Manitoba, you know, obviously small business, hospitality industries, tourism industries continue to be challenged as well. Some of the things that you highlighted as well about the continued supports coming from the federal government, I wonder if you might want to touch upon that a little bit in terms of what some of those sectors that are continuing to face hardships, not knowing when they're going to get back to normal, what some of the plans from the federal government perspective to make sure that those key industries are going to have the supports that they're going to need until we can get back to that new normal for them?
Thank you. Thank you, Chuck. That's a great question. First of all, I think we need to recognize that the last 2 years have been unprecedented in Canada, in the world. Literally, life has come to a standstill. And I know you've heard this many times, but we took a whole of government approach to ensure that we had Canadians back from the beginning to the end. Having said that, we're not at the end yet. And I think the Prime Minister and the Deputy Prime Minister very often make the case that the first priority is getting on the other side of the pandemic, because until we do, the economy can never fully return to normal. Our children's education can never return to normal. The best thing we can do for the economy right now is get on the other side of this darn pandemic. And with the latest variant that was announced a week ago, it just made things a little bit more complicated, but we're still positive. We've acted quickly, and we're taking all hands are on deck to beat this pandemic. Just last month, emanating from the throne speech, we introduced Bill C-2 to help with some of the hardest hit sectors. We are extending the Canada Recovery Hiring Program until May of 2022 for eligible employers with current revenue loss above 10% and increasing the subsidy rate to 50%. We are extending the Tourism and Hospitality Recovery Program, which would provide support through the wage and rent subsidy programs to hotels, tour operators, travel agencies, and restaurants. In keeping with our promise that Canadians in the last election, to Canadians with a subsidy rate of 75%. We are extending the hardest hit business recovery programs, which would provide support through the wage and rent subsidy program. These programs will all be extended to May 7th, 2022. And this Bill C-2 is on the docket now. It's going to be debated. It hasn't passed yet. I believe the will is there to pass. I just wish we could extend, we could approve Bill C-2 the way we approved a bill last week with all government support. So it'll be debated, I think, in the new year, but I'm confident that we will approve it.
Okay. Minister, well, let's touch upon PrairiesCan. And I think this is, you know, obviously something from an organizational perspective from the Manitoba Chamber of Commerce, and we've been big fans of the work that your team has done and your people on the ground here in Manitoba through WD and now through the new PrairiesCan. So, you know, and specifically as well, I think there was some big concern always kind of going on when we were hiving off BC, that there was going to be a concern that we were going to lose that budget as well would kind of go with it. But that's obviously not been the case. The budget for PrairiesCan between the three provinces continues as is. You know, from your perspective now being the minister responsible for this, so what do you kind of see as the vision for where you would like PrairiesCan to go? You kind of talked a little bit about, you know, having more boots on the ground and having offices in Thompson and Brandon. And in terms of what kind of programs are you hoping and what kind of engagement are you looking for through PrairiesCan with the business community and through communities throughout the province?
Yeah, that's a great question. First of all, I think the fact that you have a minister overseeing PrairiesCan from Winnipeg, Manitoba, as opposed to somebody outside of the prairies is incredibly positive. And I take a team approach to everything we do. I'm looking for advice and counsel from my Manitoba MP colleagues, Jim, Terry, and Kevin, as well as two new MPs in Alberta we meet regularly on prairies related issues. And let's face it, this is a nonpartisan issue. I'm meeting with members of parliament from Alberta and Saskatchewan all the time. I've been here 2 weeks now and I've had many good conversations. I've been to Edmonton to make an announcement on hydrogen power. I've been to Saskatoon to make an announcement on value-added agriculture incubator. So our priority is those businesses that are going to grow and create jobs in the future. We know that traditionally the three prairie provinces have been energy provinces and they will remain energy provinces. Our challenge now is to make that transformation as quickly and as best we can, and it will be a transformation because we don't get to net zero without using the expertise, the know-how, the knowledge of people in the energy sector that are there now, traditional energy sector engineers and workers. So my role is to grow and diversify the prairie economy, to work with the private sector, to work with academia, to work with other stakeholders, to identify those niche industries and markets that we need to improve, to invest in, and to grow.
Based on that as well, Minister Vandal, you kind of touched upon the fact that you're now representing the three provinces, and it obviously it's great having you, based here in Manitoba, but what kind of a message would you send to Manitoba businesses and organizations like ourselves to make sure that, you know, we always kind of talk about this, that Manitoba gets our fair share and that we're there at the table and we're making sure that things that are going to be important kind of going forward are going to be addressed so that, you know, obviously Alberta and Saskatchewan are going to have their priorities as well. But how important is that kind of going forward as well that, you know, sometimes, you know, we don't do a good job here in Manitoba as organizations, business leaders, you know, making sure that we're connected and knowing specifically now that we've got this new entity based locally here, you know, what kind of message would you send to really those Manitoba business owners?
Great question. I was actually quite surprised when I received one of my first briefings when some of the public service told me that traditionally there's less applications that come from Manitoba than Alberta and Saskatchewan. And I said, really? Are you sure about that? And they said, over the years, there's been less applications. And that's something that A, I wasn't aware, and B, we have to change. I think the very fact that we are opening offices in Brandon and Thompson, that people are going, storefront offices that people are going to see, and it's an incredible opportunity to outreach, to engage, to talk with leaders in those cities, in those regions, who maybe don't know what the services that PrairiesCan offers. So I think my job and all of our job as a Prairie caucus and a Manitoba caucus is to get out there and talk about about the economy, to get out there to talk about the services that PrairiesCan does provide, and that we will you know, it's networking on perhaps a higher level, working with chambers of commerces and business improvement zones and other industry associations is the way to do that. And between the prairies and the north, we're going to have a lot of activity.
So we need to do our jobs to increase the number of projects, and specifically, I think you targeted as well. I mean, we're looking for industries that are going to create jobs is really critical for us kind of going forward as well. So, you know, I want to touch upon something as well and maybe get a little bit of clarity from you. And there a report yesterday out of the Winnipeg Free Press reported that funding to those hardest hit sectors was allocated to all economic development agencies across the country, except for PrairiesCan. Example, they said a $10.5 million aerospace fund will go to Ontario. BC companies will get $30 million for tourism, Ontario and BC. You know, and we're wondering, can you elaborate on the report that came out yesterday on the pandemic recovery program through PrairiesCan, and why apparently, according to Free Press, Manitoba was not allocated any funding this round?
That is inaccurate, 100% inaccurate. It's a story that was spun by MP Daniel Blakey, who's a great MP, doing his work. The reality is, I mentioned the dollars that were announced in the 2021 budget for PrairiesCan. That's something that we're solid on as a government. It's unwavering. The inside baseball part of the story on this is that in the House of Commons, we have three processes called supplementary estimates, A, B, and C. Next Tuesday, there's supplementary estimate B that's going to be debated with certain amount of funding on it. In February, there's going to be supplementary estimates C, where the PrairiesCan money will be debated. And a large part of that is already invested and spent and distributed. So that money is 100% solid. That I just told you the inside baseball of how the House of Commons works, but the budget is what's important. We have all of our party and our government that is 100% committed to moving that funding to PrairiesCan, and it's not going to change. And you can take that to the bank.
Excellent. So that's great to clear that up, that the money for PrairiesCan is there, it's allocated, it's what we would expect.
It's solid.
Excellent. So let's talk a little bit about the North. And your government has long talked about really the importance of the North. In fact, you know, the mandate letter that you provided by Prime Minister Trudeau in regards to leading the government's work to create more economic opportunity and a higher quality of life in the North, while also acting in support of sovereignty and national interest. And it includes the strengthening of that relationship with the territorial governments and really advancing policy and programs that support Northerners. Can you maybe give us a bit of an update in terms of, you know, in your time as Minister of the North, some of the progress that you've made and how that really strategy impacts? And I'm specific to obviously to Northern Manitoba. I know we've got a number of Northern Manitoba stakeholders on the call here today.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first of all, I've mentioned Churchill. Our government believes that Churchill is an important part, and Northern Manitoba are important players in the Arctic and Northern Policy Framework, which is the overarching vision document that everyone has signed on to. We've invested over $170 million in the Port of Churchill. We feel that in the full, as time wears on, Churchill will only become more important in as a transportation hub and a tourism hub. So we are there. We are actively working with the community, and hopefully there's more to come on that. Again, we have in all of my travels in the North, both virtual and on the ground travel, an issue that comes up the most often is housing. And infrastructure. And the reality is that without adequate housing and without good modern infrastructure, that's the key to actually making sure people are safe and healthy. And that's the key to making sure that the economy can thrive. When I talk to the Mining Association, infrastructure comes up very often. So we're taking a whole of government approach. We have Canada's largest infrastructure program as well as housing program. I'm working with those ministers to make sure the investments move forward to the north. I've mentioned housing. We have 10-year housing agreements with all three territories. 10-year housing agreements that are going to invest close to $900 million in safe, affordable housing. We have a 10-year housing agreement with Inuit rights holders in Inuit Nunangat, worth about $400 million. We've invested over $500 million with NTI, which is Inuit rights holders in Nunavut, for infrastructure. And unlike previous Indigenous Government of Canada agreements, they don't have to make an application to the government and justify where they're going to spend their money. It's a nation-to-nation, government-to-government agreement where they will invest in marine infrastructure, some housing. It's up to NTI to make those priorities on where that money is going to be invested. And I think it comes down to relationships. I speak to the premiers of the territories regularly. I know that Nunavut now has a new premier, PJ Agiakok. We've had a great conversation last week. I'm looking forward to going up to Nunavut to continue those conversations and how our governments can work together.
It's interesting you mentioning relationships, Minister Vandal, because one of the things, and we held an event last week with the World Trade Center Winnipeg, as well as the Business Council of Manitoba.
Right, yes.
And one of the biggest challenges we always find, and this is sort of a Manitoba thing in terms of our relationship with the far north, is that, you know, when down here in Winnipeg and we talk about the north, we're usually talking about Flin Flon, the Paw and Churchill, and that's about as far as we go. But there's greater opportunities a little further north as well, and some that we haven't really taken advantage of. And in fact, you know, what a number of stakeholders talked about is that, you know, we've been kind of losing a lot of business to Quebec and to other provinces that have, you know, really taken advantage of that. And, you know, there was really a discussion about how do we rebuild that relationship and really look at that supply chain from northern Manitoba to the Rankin Inlets and to Nunavut as well. And so I wonder if you can maybe touch upon that in terms of where you see that opportunity. Obviously, your government has made significant investments in the rail line and in the Churchill port. Is that where you see it as well from your perspective, is that we really have an opportunity here and that's why these investments are critical moving forward?
Absolutely. I think Churchill has a very important role to play in the future development of the North and the Arctic. And that's really one of the main reasons why we've been fully supportive of working with them to make sure that through the Arctic Gateway Group, they can remain sustainable. We're hoping to have more government partners going forward in the next short little while. Those are conversations and relationships that we need to work on as well. I think another part of my mandate letter in 2019 was to advance hydroelectricity and grid interconnection projects in the north. Kivalliq Hydro Fiber Link project in Nunavut is something that we've been working on. We've invested tens of millions of dollars on feasibility studies and other work with stakeholders from the Kivalliq region. The plan is that we have a hydroelectric connection between the Kivalliq region, which is Rankin Inlet and Arviat, down to Manitoba, as well as a hydroelectric connection, as well as the jobs associated with that. Fiber. So that's something that's incredibly important. We're in close contact all of the time, and it's part of the solution. And the other part is just to continue to invest in road construction, in transportation. Isolation means things are more expensive. So the more isolated you are, the more it's going to cost. Food insecurity is a very, very real issue in the north, and that's something that we are trying to address through our program called Nutrition North. but it's a much wider problem than one program. There needs to be a whole of government investment through Agriculture Canada, working with the governments of the North and the Arctic as well, and working with the private sector and academia to try to address the food insecurity issue.
We've got about 10 minutes left, Mr. Vandal, and I want to talk a little bit more about relationships. And, you know, over the last number of years, and, you know, being a former city councillor as well, you know, some of the challenges that that municipalities deal with in terms of being able to get programs forwarded to through the various levels of government. And I think over the last number of years, there's been some, I wouldn't say some prickly discussions between the various levels of government. And I think we've had a bit of a reset, obviously, with a, you know, obviously, you know, your government being reelected in a minority situation, a new premier in place now here in Manitoba. So I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about, do you see that there's an opportunity to reset some of those relationships? Because what we were seeing, I think, a lot in the past, whether it was things like the water treatment plant or other infrastructure projects, a lot of finger pointing going in different directions as to who's holding things up. So, yeah. You know, I'm just interested in, you know, now you as that senior minister for Manitoba in terms of what you want to see in terms of what that relationship looks like with the other various levels of government here in Manitoba.
Yes, great question. I think we need to realize that as elected officials, we're all serving the same people in Winnipeg, in Manitoba, and that we can do a much better job if we work together, whether we're talking about economic growth, whether we're talking about safe childhood programs, whether we're talking about you name it. We need to work together. I've always had a fantastic relationship with Mayor Bowman. He's been accessible. I have a couple of very good city councilors in my riding, St. Vital and St. Boniface, where we get together regularly to talk about the issues and work together to try to move those forward. I've had a very good conversation with the new premier of Manitoba, I think on it was Remembrance Day. And I'm looking forward to continuing that conversation once I get back to Winnipeg for the Christmas break to identify those projects that that we can partner on. Our government is set out a bold and ambitious agenda. $10 a day daycare is something that we want to see implemented ASAP. I know the government of Manitoba, very happy to say they've signed off on the agreement. And what that means is that by the end of 2022, we should have daycare fees cut by 50% by the end of the year. Now that's going to be a huge benefit to Manitoba families. We talk about inflation. We haven't talked about it yet, but it's people are speaking about it now. Well, affordability is what that childcare promise and commitment and agreement is going to deliver. Affordability for Manitoba families, which means more women more women being available for the workforce, contributing in a positive, productive way in the workforce, which is what our economy needs. So that's just one example of what our government needs to work on to get better results. You know, infrastructure is a huge one. I'm glad we made the progress on the North End wastewater treatment plant. I'm glad. I'm extremely happy as a former city councilor and a former public works chairperson for 2 years that Winnipeg and Manitoba were able to actually sit down together and make that announcement that they're going to move it forward. Our government is ecstatic about that, and I look forward to seeing that file. And really moving it forward so that we can solve that issue. I know that myself and Terry Duguid, Terry has a lot of knowledge about it. He was a former counselor as well. It's incredible progress, and it would be great if we could finally put that one to bed in the near future.
We're nearing the end of our time, Minister Vandal, but I, you know, just before we started today, another news release came by, and I know you've probably got one of the longest titles in terms of departments, so I don't imagine you can fit it a lot on a business card, but I know you got some additional ones today with Prime Minister Trudeau has appointed you as a cabinet committee lead on a number of different files as well. And specifically, you know, I know you're sitting on the Committee for Economy, Inclusion and Climate and for federal response to COVID-19, but the one I was interested in and the one that you've been asked by the Prime Minister to chair is on the Cabinet Committee on Reconciliation. And that's an issue, obviously, that has been front and center across Canada over the course of this past year. So maybe just to our viewers, can you talk a little bit about what that means and how you kind of see that role as Cabinet Committee on Reconciliation in terms of, you know, what your government's, you know, sort of position is going to be going forward on this important file?
Yes, it's incredibly honored that the Prime Minister asked me to chair that committee. Once again, I was the chair for the last since mid-2019, I believe. Our government is investing billions of dollars in reconciliation from schools, education, healthcare, oil water advisories, resolving claims of injustices that have occurred in our history, tens of billions of dollars. What it means as a chairperson of Reconciliation Committee is that before any programs or settlements or initiatives are moved forward publicly, there's a private analysis and vetting amongst the cabinet on every issue, really. But on anything to do with reconciliation, that would come to the Reconciliation Committee. There's quite a few members on it. I'm not sure if I know Mark Miller is on it and Patty High do for sure, because we work very closely together. Those initiatives would come forward to the Reconciliation Committee for an explanation, for an analysis, further analysis, and just clarification of what this means for everyone to be fully supportive. So it's really an overview, high level overview of major initiatives coming forward. And listen, I know that the Prime Minister often says there's no issue, no relationship more important than the one between the government and Indigenous peoples, and I agree 100%. We've made great strides. For example, I sat with the minister 2 years ago for the announcement of $250 million for four new schools in northern Manitoba, which means the 2,600 students will be able to get an education in their community. They will not have to leave. That's something that is profound and is going to be so positive for generations. Those are the results of much of our investment, and we've done great work. But the gaps are so large that, unfortunately, it's not very noticeable. But we're going to keep going.
I know that there's been some questions in what we'll do with some of these as well, as we'll forward them to your office and we'll email them back. We'll have this program as well. So Minister, I want to thank you very much for spending some time with the Manitoba Chambers of Commerce this afternoon. It has been greatly appreciated. Maybe sort of one final question. And I know you, in your role as Minister responsible for Prairies Canada, you're responsible for Manitoba, Saskatchewan, and Alberta. Well, we've got a big game coming up this weekend. So how do you have to stay neutral, or can you pick sides in terms of who's going to win the Western final?
Hey, I'm a Winnipegger. I'm a Manitoban. I'll be there on Sunday, and I'm going to be cheering for the Bombers.
Wow, we're glad to hear that, Minister Vandal, and I'm sure most Manitobans will as well. And hopefully, in a week and a half's time, we'll be holding a parade in downtown Winnipeg to help stimulate that as well. So again, on behalf of the Manitoba Chambers of Commerce, thank you very much for spending some time with us this afternoon, Minister Vandal.
Thank you so much. Merci.
Thank you, Minister Vandal, for this excellent discussion. And throughout the pandemic, our business community has been confronted with a whole host of new economic realities. And we're not out of the woods yet, but there are glimmers of hope. And from our perspective, Manitoba must remain competitive to attracting investment. But in addition to securing new investment, now more than ever, we must champion our existing entrepreneurs and SMEs, particularly those in the hospitality, food services, and tourism industry. We must also continue to work to enable access to capital to help Manitoba-born success stories scale up their operations. And finally, government must be prepared to support the creation of good quality jobs that Manitobans to thrive and not just survive while investing in digital infrastructure, a lot of the things that the government has talked about. We want to thank the government as well for support local initiatives that they've supported. An investment of $1 million in our organization has allowed us to approve close to $600,000 in support local campaigns developed by local chambers across the province, as well as over $250,000 in campaigns for a number of not-for-profit organizations committed to supporting local businesses in the community. We would encourage you on the line, use the hashtag BuyLocalMB. You can have a chance to win a $100 prepaid gift card. A very special thanks to 6P Marketing, our MB Poly Power Hour series presenting sponsor. And thank you to Minister Vandal for sharing your vision for Manitoba with us today. We look forward to working with your office and Prairies Can, as well with CanNor, in advancing economic development in our highly diversified and industry-rich industries. Up next for us on our will be next Thursday, December 9th, for a presentation of findings from the 2021 Manitoba Business Outlook Survey. We'll host Leger's Executive Vice President, Winnipeg, Andrew Enns, for a result of the results and themes. And then on December 15th, Manitoba's Minister of Economic Development and Jobs, the Honourable John Reyes, will join us to take the virtual stage for our next MB Poly Power Hour. You can check out all these events online at www.jointhechamber.ca and register to join. I want to thank everyone for participating today. Have a great weekend, and we look forward to joining us again at another Manitoba Chambers of Commerce event. Have a great day, everyone.